Melbourne Cup, the race that stops a nation, is Australia's most famous thoroughbred horse race. Conducted as a part of Melbourne's Spring Racing Carnival, this 3,200-meter race is the richest two-mile handicap in the world. Began in 1861, the story of Melbourne Cup is also the story of horse racing in Victoria. As Melbourne evolved from a rudimentary town of few thousand people to a cosmopolitan city of millions, its love for the sport of horse racing also grew with it. There are not many details about the first horse race held in Melbourne apart from a newspaper report. On the 15th of January 1838, a meeting of sporting gentlemen was convened at John Faulkner's Hotel in Melbourne. The purpose was to organise a race meeting. The chair was occupied by Henry Allen, Henry Arthur and William Wood. Francis Noden and David Morley were appointed as committee members. The meeting also decided that no horses should be entered unless they were the real property of a subscriber to the race fund of £2. The locality selected for the course was Batman's Hill, where the Southern Cross station now stands, then one of the beauty spots of Melbourne. The running track was outlined by a few stake, saplings, and broad palings lashed together. The grandstand was formed by the lashing together of two large bullock drays. The jumps were made of few logs and gum tree branches. Refreshment booths consisted of trucks surrounded by wooden uprights into which old sails and bags were nailed. The jockeys' outfits were red and blue flannel shirts, cabbage tree hats, and leather leggings, combined with spurs and a piece of knotted whipcord. Jockeys rode the race for the owners, and most newspapers completely ignored the identity of the jockeys. For the race, most of the organisers, being expatriates from Hobart, copied the ways and means of Town Plate in Hobart. Prize money for Town Plate was 100 sovereigns and Melbourne offered 25 sovereigns, not a small amount considering the population of Melbourne at that time. It was a handicap race and the committee set out a weight for age scale. Three-year-old colts and fillies carried the lowest weight, and six-year-olds and older carried highest. Two of the earliest publicans, John Faulkner and Michael Carr, put up refreshment booths, formed out of small carts or trucks, and rum, brandy, ginger beer, and bottled porter were retailed at 1 shilling a glass. The Town Plate attracted three entries, the winner being Robinson's Postboy. On the 9th of February 1839, another meeting was held at Lamb Inn in Collins Street for the purpose of electing stewards for the Melbourne races. These were eventually held on March 15th and 16th, as per the English Jockey Club rules. The Town Plate went to Mr. Brown's mare, Mountain Maid. Another meeting at Lamb Inn, on October 1839, began preparing for the race planned on March 1840. But before that, a private race was run at Flemington, and the superiority of this place for a racecourse suggested itself so forcibly that it determined to hold future races there. But during that time, Flemington was getting mapped by the surveyor for being sold as farming lots. But at the request of the stewards, Lieutenant Governor Charles Latrobe agreed to keep five of those lots aside for being used as racecourse. But they belonged to the Crown and never alienated as freehold. Even today, they are Crown land on lease to the Victoria Racing Club as trustees. Many complained about the distance from the city centre to the racecourse. Racing at Flemington, then known as Melbourne Racecourse, began on the 3rd of March 1840. The Town Plate was on the 4th of March. The grandstand was a rough scaffolding near the riverside. There were four booths, three of which were small tents. The mode of transit for the public to the racecourse were horseback, bullock dray, or raw by river, but majority of spectators simply walked. Even after the first organised horse racing in Flemington in 1840, Melbourne didn't have an annual committee to run 1841 race meeting. Racing was controlled by a temporary committee formed for each annual racing. Need of the hour resulted in William Verner, Honorary Secretary of Melbourne Club, to take the initiative to form Port Phillip Turf Club to organise annual race meetings. The club organised race meetings in 1841 and 1842, but didn't last after that. The first race meeting by Port Phillip Turf Club was on April 1841. Port Phillip Turf Club, which lasted 2 years, is considered as the first racing club in Melbourne. For the next few years, temporary committees arranged annual race meetings. The 1851 race before the discovery of gold was marred by many incidents of drunkenness. In 1851, gold was discovered in Victoria. All roads were leading to gold towns of Victoria and Melbourne was deserted. Victoria Turf Club was formed in 1852 to organise horse racing at Flemington. To reduce the risk of drunkenness, liquor was banned from booths at the 1852 races. Victoria Turf Club was spreading its wings and tried to strengthen its control over Melbourne Racecourse by preventing others from using the racecourse. This resulted in the birth of Victoria Jockey Club in 1856. Argus reported that around 80 gentlemen assembled at Tattersall's Hotel for the purpose of establishing a Victoria Jockey Club. Victoria Jockey Club ran its inaugural race meeting on the 18th of February 1857 at the Melbourne Racecourse. Another private race in 1857 caught the imagination of the settlers of Victoria. Andrew Spencer Chirnside, a wealthy grazier, so proud of his mare, Alice Hawthorne's abilities, boasted no horse can beat his mare. His challenge for a championship of the colonial turf, to be run over 3 miles at Flemington on the 3rd of October 1857, for a prize money of £1,000, was taken up by George Rowe of Liverpool in New South Wales. Unexceptionable weather and a program of unusual interest brought together some 15 or 20,000 people, some say, more to witness the great match. For some hours before the commencement of the race, every available vehicle was charted by anxious sightseers, and the road from end to end presented one unbroken line of horses, cabs, and carriages of every description. Alice Hawthorne ran well throughout, but from the very outset it was manifest she was not equally matched, and on her arrival at the winning post she was found to be severely punished. The 1859 championship race at Melbourne Racecourse was a forerunner to Melbourne Cup. The Argus reported, "The race for the championship of the Australian colonies is over, witnessed by 35,000 people, and won by a Victorian horse, Flying Buck, when the prospects of Victorian preeminence were dubious, came to the rescue, saved the national reputation, and achieved a victory." The racecourse trustees reaped a good profit from championship race, and decided to invest some of it to make Flemington Racecourse better. The racecourse was remodeled, repositioned the finishing post, new grandstand was built and fenced off, 14 acres as spectators' enclosure. Now, the spectators could obtain a bird's eye view of the whole course. The railways reached till Flemington, by then making the transport easier from the city to Flemington. In February 1861, Victoria Turf Club advertised for entries to the first Melbourne Cup, modelled after Chester Cup in England. Chief Police Commissioner, Captain Frederick Standish, and his fellow committee members of the Victorian Turf Club are credited with the idea of Melbourne Cup. The race was a handicap based on the weight for age scale. The 2 mile race was the perfect race Melbourne ever hosted. A field of 18 horses started, the largest number ever brought together in Victoria. Immediately after the start, the favourite, Dispatch, tumbled, and two other mares, Medora and Twilight, fell over her. Dispatch and Medora were injured so as to necessitate them being killed, but the jockeys, though severely injured, have escaped with life. The race was won by a Sydney horse, Archer. The prize handed out to Archer was 710 gold sovereigns and a hand-beaten gold watch. The first trophy cup to a winner of Melbourne Cup was awarded in 1865. The owner of the winning horse, Tory Boy, Mr. Marshall, described the trophy as a monstrosity and sold it to the Flemington Hunt Club. Flemington Hunt Club rebranded it as the trophy for its annual cup and inscribed on it, "The Flemington Hunt Club Cup awarded to the 1873 winner, Babbler." It was sold by Christie's in 1970. There was a crowd of around 4,000 for the first Melbourne Cup, and it increased steadily thereafter. Melbourne Cup was initially run on the first Thursday in November, until the Carnival of 1875, and from then onwards it was switched to the first Tuesday in November. The Cup Day gradually became an unofficial holiday for Melbournians, and as early as 1865, Cup Day was a half-day holiday for public servants and bank officials. The Government Gazette of the 31st of October 1837 declared it as bank and public service holiday, and since then it remained a holiday in Melbourne. In 1864, Victorian Turf Club and Jockey Club amalgamated to form the Victoria Racing Club, which came to be the controlling body of racing in Victoria from its headquarters at Flemington. From a mere 4,000 spectators in 1861, now 4 days of the famous racing extravaganza attracts a four-day crowd of close to 400,000 people, and watched by millions in mini screens around the globe. Race day fashion makes an even bigger news item every year, and it all began with the media attention received in 1965, when British model Jean Shrimpton appeared at the races wearing a white shift dress, which ended 13 centimeters above her knees, wearing no hat, stockings or gloves, and sporting a man's watch. With the increased coverage of the race around the world, the prize money also skyrocketed. The total prize money for the 2019 race was $8 million, plus trophies valued at $250,000. With more than 150 years of history behind it, one thing is certain: Melbourne Cup is here to stay, probably for a few more centuries or forever.